to Connie Martinson Talks Books. There is a saying, be careful of what you want. You may get it, and there may be a price to be paid for it. Well, that was never truer than the story of The White Queen. It is a novel based on history written by my guest, Philippa Gregory, and it's published by Touchstone, Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Philippa.
Thank you.
And it is Be Careful of What You Want. And it's not only a Lady Elizabeth Grey who becomes the White Queen, but her mother.
They're a very ambitious family, but I think when she initially meets the young prince, the young king, Edward IV of England, she is really just asking for the rights to her dowry land. And then what unfolds, really, the dramatic story of her life is pretty unexpected.
The love, I mean, it is unbelievable, like a true novel, how the two of them, they meet in a little hunting lodge, no one is to know, and they are married. Not in secret, but what was it in?
Her mother says, not secret, but private. It's a private wedding. And that's really very key because a secret wedding, it's hard to make it valid. But it is a private wedding. Her mother is there. We know a priest was there. We know there was another witness there. So it was a valid wedding.
And she had been a widow. He supposedly had been married to someone before. So it plays back with the brothers who would like to say, wait a minute, we should be number one for the king. You are the bastard, and besides which, your marriage was not legal.
That's really the kind of conspiracy by one of the brothers, George, Duke of Clarence, about the middle of their life. But really what starts off for Elizabeth is there's no question that he's married before. He marries her for love. He's the first ruling king of England to ever marry anyone for love. He marries an English commoner, which nobody's ever done before either. And she's a widow, so she has this whole family who, of course, arrive at court with her expecting places and position and fortune and influence. And, of course, the brothers, George and Richard, are absolutely horrified at, in a sense, this whole new family who come in to what's already very delicately poised between the York's family and the Lancaster family as to who is to rule England anyway.
Because Edward, who was her love, the King Edward, he had defeated Henry, and old King Henry is in the Tower, and he really sounds like he has dementia.
You'd have to try and do a diagnosis from what they say. Just say he falls asleep. So he seems to kind of drift into a sort of coma. He's not an old man. He just drifts into a sort of coma and then he wakes up again after. But in all fairness, he's related to one of the kings of France who believed he was made of glass and wouldn't let people touch him for fear he shattered. So you're not talking about people whose sanity is entirely solid.
And poor Lady Elizabeth Grey, nay Queen, is sitting in her home waiting to find out, will King Edward announce that he is married and that she is his queen? And then, especially because his influence is a man named the Duke of Warwick.
This is Warwick the Kingmaker, that people who know English history, it's a very familiar name. He's the one who basically says of the House of York, he's going to make them kings. King Henry, who's the mad one, is of the House of Lancaster, and he doesn't have an adult heir, and he has this very domineering French wife, and the English don't like the French very much then, or indeed now, has to be said. And so he's really, his power is in decline, and Warwick the Kingmaker takes the York family and says, we can be kings of England. Edward's father tries to do it. Edward himself actually achieves it. And so his first council, they're planning a marriage, an arranged marriage for him with a European princess to secure England's position in Europe. And he has to announce that he can't marry her because he's already married. And that's when Elizabeth comes to court.
And she comes to court. And fortunately, she eventually becomes pregnant. And she has two girls, but then she has a son, Prince Edward.
It's another Edward. One of the complaints my editor said to me is everyone is either Edward, George or Richard in this book. It's absolutely true, but she has a boy and they call him Prince Edward. She actually gives birth to him in sanctuary. It's a time when the Yorks are losing in this continual period of warfare that goes on. She has to go into sanctuary underneath Westminster Abbey. She has to go into hiding almost. And instead of having a royal birth with all of the, you know, ceremony, but also the safety precautions, she's on her own really in sanctuary and they send in a midwife to her. And that's it. And she manages to have a live boy.
You do a wonderful thing as an author because every chapter has a last line that is really a page turner, and it's always, you know, wait a minute, what's going to happen next?
Well, I feel very strongly that the historical novel is a form of literature which has, the way I write it, the way I like it to be, basically two major principles. And one is that the history's got to be absolutely accurate and absolutely exact when we know it. And the other is that the novel has to work as a novel. I'm not writing a history book. It's not for history majors. I'm writing a novel that if you want, you can read on the lounger and throw it away at the end of it. Or if you want, you can put it in your library and consult it as a history source. It's got to be both for me. So the novel form of it, the fiction side of it, you know, the characters have got to be dramatic and the narration's got to be moving and the dialogue's got to be lively. It's all got to work just as if it were a contemporary novel.
You said sanctuary, and later in the book, there's a point where Lady, or the Queen Elizabeth, says, he broke the sanctuary, and King Edward has killed people who were in sanctuary. That later plays back